In 1982, the movie Tron was a milestone in bringing computer-generated 3D geometrical graphics to audiences. The special effects may look ancient now, but at the time they were cutting edge. In 1982, video games mostly looked like this. And this. So the movie looked damned impressive comparatively. The film features a computer programmer who is doing battle with tech giant bosses in the real world, but he gets sucked into a computer. He's digitized and then continues his battle inside the surrealist world, where computer data and processing are represented in geometric forms, and specific pieces of software or code are anthropomorphized as living, thinking human beings. There's also a paradigm where the programs look facially like their human programmers or users in the real world. A war against computer-controlled technocracy ensues with lots of interesting details and aesthetics. The computer world is dark and textureless, like the surface of the monolith in 2001. In keeping with the graphical limitations of the time, the world mostly lacks detail. The geometric edges of polygons frequently consist of bright lines, a bit like solid laser beams. Unlike with today's video games and CGI, Tron doesn't try to hide its geometry. It exaggerates it, purposely looking very different to the real world. It was like a new type of cartoon. Several of the characters carry a sort of data disk with them that holds information and can be used as a weapon. CDs and DVDs weren't on the market yet, but floppy disks were in use. They had square casings, but the storage disk inside was circular, like with hard drives generally. Being that the computer world depicted is run by an evil corporate boss, it has a hard, cold, empty, and emotionless aesthetic. But with some unoccupied territories, there are curved green hills, bubbles, and so on. So the harsh, dark geometry we see in most of the film didn't have to be that way. There were other options, special effects-wise. The harsh geometry is a chosen aesthetic. To emphasize the conflict between the straight cubic and the spherical, there's even a shot where one of the oppressor vehicles is destroying bubbles in the wilderness as it flies. The hard geometry changes once the oppressor is defeated. The world is morphed so that it has more light and color and becomes more fluid in appearance, a bit less geometrical. Note the inclusion of circles on these towers, and the sudden sense of organic rippling here. An amusing detail is these things called grid bugs, which raises an important point about how even programmers themselves anthropomorphize computer code. Programmers back in 1982 and now, they referred to computer code errors as bugs. In doing so, they subconsciously give computer code a three-dimensional shape. Insects are much more geometrically solid on the outside than we humans, because of their exoskeletons. Isn't it interesting that computer programmers don't refer to code errors as germs? I mean, germs, when seen under a microscope, are pretty organic looking, soft and flexible. Germs are also a nuisance. But programmers do refer to self-replicating problem codes as viruses. Actual viruses are so small and difficult to see, even with microscopes, that in the public mind, they lack defined shape. Well, until recent years, when a certain virus was given prominently defined shape with extensive media coverage. The film includes an excellent visual parallel between the computer-generated world aesthetics and the set designs and visuals of the human world. Here, a helicopter landing includes a lot of the kind of neon geometry that's seen in the computer world in the same movie. This office space has what looks like an endless plane of cuboid prison cells for the workers. See how the edges of the cubicle squares are in white to emphasize their geometry? Cold hard geometry in the villain's office as well, and behind him the city at night is a gridwork of streetlight lines. He's even mirrored in the desk, being that he has a mirror personality within the computer world. The company labs are full of cuboid scaffolding, and there's emphasis on geometry in the lowering platform in the back there. When they test their digitized machine on organic matter, they test it on a spherical orange, cubizing it in the process. Cubizing, I think I just made up a new word there. Now, there's loads of this stuff in the film, and I think the point is that the rigid, inflexible, straight-lined geometric reality of the game world basically represents the machine-like, inflexible, rigid bureaucracies and corporations of the human world. At one point, in a safe haven, some of the characters in the computer world who are on the run come across that fabulous substance that computer components can't survive in, water. And it's not a graphical representation of water, it's actual water. Water isn't just life-giving. In this game world, it defies the hard, oppressive geometry of the giant prison that they're trying to get out of. Some parts of this world give me the impression of being like the surfaces of computer circuit boards, such as the bike chasers creating pathways. There are senseless geometric symbols on the big walls here and in other scenes. Not sure what they mean, if anything. But check this out. Flynn, the lead character, gets digitized against his will. He is initially segmented into cubes, and then we get a trippy journey into the game world akin to 2001 Stargate. There's much greater emphasis on geometry here though, and various gridded shapes fly past us that look a lot like those Pentamino game pieces that we explored earlier. For those of you who might be thinking it's a Tetris game reference, nope, the movie came out 2 years before the Tetris game did. So why these particular shapes? I don't know. A disorienting float through a 3D cubic grid universe, and then a polygon Earth with gridded clouds. In opposition to our world, where geometry is an illusion, in this world there is almost nothing but geometry. Like I've already said, the ensuing battle that spans the rest of the film is partially a battle between straight-edged geometry and curvature. And so when a couple of the good guys meet up with an ally called the Guardian, who has an amusing costume, especially the head, his little realm mostly uses curved structures, not cubism. Overall, the film has a plot that rallies against oppression, and that oppression is presented in the form of rigid, lifeless geometry. But I think the anti-technocratic and arguably anti-geometrical message was mostly overshadowed by the novelty wow factor that the universe presented when the film was released. So it's well worth going back to Tron and re-watching it as a warning about over-digitization, over-mathematicalization, I don't even know if that's a word, but I love it, over-cubization, I don't even know if that's a word. It's worth watching the movie as a warning against that stuff. But I've outlined elements of Tron here partially because the film was such a milestone in terms of technical computer graphics, but more important because it was one of the first culturally prominent presentations of a physically impossible geometric reality. Since the film came out, real-time video games initially spent many years playing catch-up before eventually far surpassing Tron's look. There is a cliché-laden remake of the film, but it lacks the novelty, impact and significance of the original, and it concentrates way too much on that boring cliché of parkour action scenes. It also unwisely discards a lot of the rigid geometry that made the game world look so alien in the original film. And something that's easy to overlook visually in the original Tron is that there's hardly any depth of field, hardly anything is ever out of focus. We can think of that as crap graphics, but I think it enhances the surrealness of the world in a good way. At the visual level, the world is literally shallow. The Tron remake brought depth of field into the digitized world, but all it does is make the world look more familiar and ironically less interesting. All the effort that went into the special effects of this film only to make it look like, yeah, whatever, seen these kinds of visuals tons of times before. It even has the usual bland coloration common to a lot of modern movies, and the cliches of the superhero slam, which these days I consider to be filmmakers announcing, or at least admitting, that they lack ideas of their own. So don't ever show me a superhero slam in a new movie. If you do, you lose respect points instantly. With modern special effects capabilities, they should have broken all the visual rules to make a world that would look like nothing we've ever seen before, as happened with the original. If you're going to have textures, make them look unreal or make them look impossible. Do the same with shapes too. The tools are available, it just requires imagination. So as you can tell, I much prefer the unique look and style of the original Tron. Hell, I even find the visual look of Minecraft more interesting than Tron Legacy. And we will be covering Minecraft in detail shortly. But first, let's explore the Windows operating system. Well, folks, that was a clip from a much longer video on my website, which is linked in the video description below. If you go to the film analysis page, you'll find the long video, which is something like two hours long. Let me just double check here. Yep, there it is. It's an hour and 43 minutes, and it's called The Illusion of Cubic Reality, Picasso, 2001 A Space Odyssey, Tron, Windows, and Minecraft. So that one goes quite deep across a strange subject that spans multiple media. This idea that has dominated human civilization for a long time now. This perception that reality exists in a cubic mathematical form, which it doesn't. And you might be thinking, what the fuck? But if you go and get that video and give it a watch, there's tons and tons of stuff in there and a lot of scientific references to support it. And for those of you who are interested in retro-style gaming, I am now actually a video game designer programmer. And I've got my first game available on Steam. It can be put on the wish list at the moment. It's not actually released, but the game is almost ready for early access release. So you can follow the link on my website, or you can go to the Steam website and search for the game. It's called To the Death. And here's the Steam page with the trailer and description and so on. So if you've got a Steam account, go and add it to your wish list. And you'll find lots of movie references in the game too. See you folks soon. Bye bye.